Hello and welcome. My name is Alex, and in today's video, we'll take a look at the technical details behind what we've shown in one of our promotional videos, where basically a person receives a proactive message on his smartphone warning him of some forecasted value that's going to hit a certain threshold at some time in the future. So we're essentially talking about a data science problem here, because forecasts, as you may know, you have to have some sort of algorithm which takes the data and creates this prediction or forecast to get things out of the way first. We already have one application which does this for you, the Netilion Inventory application, which is intended, as the name suggests, to monitor your inventories and optimize your supply chain and logistics processes. That one works, for example, with these Micropilot FWR30 radar sensors. And that one gives you a linear forecast based on historical data. Now, what if a linear forecast isn't what you're searching for? What if your data has some sort of other, you know, square or logarithmic relationship over time? Well, in that case, this might not be what you're looking for. So we need to create some sort of mechanism or algorithm to do this. So let's take a look at the software architecture of what we're going to do today. So first off, we want to do some data science. And one of the most common data science tools out there to be used is the so-called Jupyter Notebook. And we're going to show you how to extract data from the Netilion API in the JSON format, so JavaScript Object Notation, and extract it via the HTTPS protocol and actually work with it inside a Jupyter Notebook. Once we're happy with our forecast algorithm inside the Jupyter Notebook, we need to be able to integrate this into a data pipeline. So this is going to be very similar to the other two videos that we have already shown, where we're going to use the Python Flask microapplication framework hosted on a Heroku instance, and we're going to be using this to process the data coming from our process plant via Netilion and send messages, if required, to any user that is interested in it. So that's it. Let's get right to it.
Let's start with a very brief introduction to time series analysis. Data coming out of a sensor in your plant could look like this. If you're analyzing data sets that cover large periods of time, there may be multiple things influencing your readings. There are, of course, irregular fluctuations. Then there may be seasonal variations as well as long-term cycles. Last but not least, there may be a general trend which is either going up or down or is stationary. Anyhow, in today's video, we will only be looking at data which has irregular fluctuations and do a short-term forecast based on the trend of the data. So let's start up our Jupyter Notebook. The first thing we have to do is get the data from Netilion into our Jupyter Notebook. For this, we import two packages, requests and JSON. Now we have a big chunk of code here already. Don't get frightened by it. It is just a method that helps us iterate through the pagination of the Netilion API, and we're just interested in what comes out of it. Let me explain what pagination is by looking inside the Netilion API documentation. So when we do a GET request, such as GET instrumentation values, and scroll down to the bottom of the response body, we often see a section called pagination. This is very relevant for what we are doing today, because there could be thousands of more historical values stored in Netilion already. In order for the API to keep response times in the range of milliseconds, large responses get split into multiple pages. However, we want to analyze all the relevant data in our Jupyter Notebook, which may be spread out over multiple pages. So all that this big chunk of code does is that it iterates through the API pagination for you and aggregates all the individual responses into a large JSON-like object. This last line here calls this method with your user-specific information, the instrumentation ID from Netilion, a base64 encoded string containing your username and password, and your API key. Now that the data is extracted, we want to be able to analyze it. A popular way to do this is by converting the data into a pandas data frame object, which we do here. This is what the first five lines of the dataset look like. As we can see, the timestamp data is still stored as a string object, which we got this way from the Netilion API. We convert this into a datetime object that can also be used as our index. So if we display the data frame now, we can see that the index is in bold writing. Did you also notice something interesting about the timestamps? For training our algorithm later, We want equidistant data points, and looking at this, I really can't guarantee that they are really equidistant throughout the whole data set. A wise man once said, trust, but verify. So we will do a resampling of the data into 10-minute intervals. Please note that you can either upsample or downsample, depending on your chosen interval. In my case, I am downsampling since my original dataset had one value every 7 or so minutes. And there we go, the timestamps look much better now. Okay, let's visualize the data in a graph. Obviously, the trend is that the value is going down in a non-linear fashion over time with some seemingly random noise. Now, noise is something that can really cause some unexpected effects when training a model. So what we can do to get a smoother line is to make a rolling average of the value. The size of the time window depends on your data. I will go for a 15-value window. Because the data is equidistant without gaps, we can also reset the index as an integer for training the algorithm later. Now we work out the rolling average value and plot it, and we can see that it became a lot smoother. Excellent. Now we're finally ready to train our model. First off, we split our data set into training and testing data, which will help us evaluate our model later. Also, we apply the so-called lasso method for regularization of the data. In a nutshell, regularization will help us prevent overfitting of our model due to coefficients getting out of hand during training. Granted, it isn't very likely to happen with our rather simple training data, but it's a best practice. Now we create a machine learning pipeline object. In here, we actually define the polynomial features of our regression analysis. In my case, I will go for an order of 2. Now let's plot the predictions based on the model against the smooth value. And we can see that the fit is quite snug, which is good. Just for reference, I also made a linear model and plotted the predictions of that as well. As we can see, the polynomial regression is a way better fit for our data. Especially when trying to make a forecast, we can see that the two lines are going two totally different directions in the end. It's great that we can visually assess the model quality in the graph, but wouldn't it be nice if we could numerically assess that as well? As in, this model is 99% accurate for the training data, and this one isn't. One way to do this is by splitting the original dataset into the training and test dataset. We actually already did this with our polynomial regression model, so now all that we gotta do is we need to score this model by using the test data, which we set aside before. And we score the predictions coming from it by comparing it with the real data. A score close to 1 is a good sign. Another common metric used to assess model quality is R-squared, which we work out here. As we can see, we are also very close to 1 with this metric, which again confirms that the model fits the data quite well. We will be using the R-squared metric later when we integrate this model into our data pipeline, respectively web application, because we obviously only want to use any predictions coming from a model that is suitable for the data. If that's not the case, R-squared will be low, and we can ignore it by setting a simple threshold. Speaking of predictions, let's actually use our model to look into the future. We can find out the maximum index of our data frame, create a new data frame with new data points, which we don't yet know the value of yet, and outer join it with our existing data frame. We let the model predict the values into the future and make a new plot to visualize it. Cool, so we now predicted probable values of the future. So what's missing now, you ask? Well, it's nice to have this in a Jupyter notebook, but how do we integrate this into our daily life? What if I want to get the forecast directly on my smartphone or similar? The only thing left to do is to take the code that we created and trigger it with new data coming straight from the field. We've actually already done something very similar in another video, only without the forecasting bit, which shows you how to create an Netilion Connect subscription, a webhook, a Python Flask application, and how to host it on Heroku. And last but not least, how to send an instant message using the Telegram bot API. If you want to catch up on those topics, please check out the link in the description, because we won't be going through those things in detail in this video. So generally speaking, there are two main ways in which we could proceed now to bring our code into this data pipeline or web application. One, you could make the model we have trained portable and use this pre-trained model for predictions. Or two, we essentially use our code to retrain and re-evaluate a new model every time new data is available. Considering that our use case here involves a relatively small dataset, training times are expected to be low. Also, we just want to extrapolate a trend in the data. The trend can also have all sorts of shapes, so we would probably need a lot of pre-trained models with option 1 to achieve anything useful. so we're going to go for option 2. If you'd like to try option 1 anyway, I'll put a link to the pickle package in the description, which is probably the easiest way to make a trained model from Scikit Learn portable. So let's dive into the fun part of integrating our training code into a web application. We're using the Flask application framework here, and here in the code, we have the target endpoint, which we want to point our Netilion webhook to. We parse the incoming JSON to extract the asset ID. I only want this to be used for a specific asset ID, which is what I use this if statement for. Now we will do a GET request on the Netilion API to obtain the latest 24 hours worth of values from that specific instrumentation. Again, we resample our data to make it equidistant and create the rolling average to smooth out the data. We now predict all of the values and compare it with the real data to work out the R-squared. If the R-squared metric is good enough, we work out the index of the point in time in the future that is of interest to us and make a prediction. In our case, we want to look 6 hours into the future, which would equate to 36 indexes, since our data points are 10 minutes apart. All we do now is that we send the forecast out as an instant message. But of course, you could add all sorts of business logic here, comparing it to thresholds, etc. So this is basically the code done. So let's test it. Now we've already shown how to deploy a Flask application to Heroku in another video, so I'm just going to demonstrate this application locally real quick by running it in the terminal. For this demonstration, here is some new data in Netilion. As we can see, the trend is now going down in a non-linear fashion. The latest value is somewhere around 57%. So to demonstrate the code that we have just created, I will now simulate an incoming Netilion webhook request, which I do using Postman. This is what the JSON would look like, and we trigger it. So now our code essentially does what was done by the Jupyter notebook before, and then sends out the predicted value as an instant message. How interesting. My fuel tank will very likely be only at 42% in a couple of hours. Maybe I should do something. So to recap, we extracted data from the Netilion API and visualized it in a Jupyter notebook. We did some basic time series data processing, such as converting string timestamps to a table index, resampling the data to make it equidistant, and created a rolling average to lessen the effects of statistical outliers. We then trained both a polynomial and a linear regression model and evaluated them using R-squared. And received forecasts into the future. Last but not least, we integrated the polynomial one into a web application framework which retrains the model and makes predictions if it's triggered by an external source. This web application can then, if it's hosted in the cloud, be triggered by a Netilion webhook, essentially automating the entire process for you. And that's it. So coming back to what we showed in our promotional video, it looked like something quite trivial, you know, getting an instant message with information based on a forecast. But I guess that if you watched this video up to this point, you know that there's a lot going on behind a simple forecast.
But to sum it up, Netilion is really a great solution to reduce the complexity of your data science projects because it takes care of the connectivity and the data storage. So that your data scientists, they can really now concentrate on the data science bit of your work to optimize your production process. Thanks for watching. I hope that you enjoyed this video and see you soon.